Welcome you all to the day five session. I'm glad to introduce today's resource person, Dr. Kota Solomon Raju. He has been working as a senior principal scientist in Digital Systems Group, CSIR, Central Electronics Engineering Research Institute, Pilani, Rajasthan, India. He received his BE from Andhra University in 1997, ME from BITS Pilani in 2003. And PhD from IIT Roorkee in 2008. His research work mainly focused on advanced embedded system, reconfigurable application-specific instruction set processor, reconfigurable computing systems for various applications such as Internet of Things, software-defined radio, WSN, automation, robotics, signal, image, video, and audio processing. Currently leading 3 R&D major projects as a principal investigator, and 6 R&D projects have been completed successfully as a principal investigator. Apart from above R&D, he has been teaching and delivering lectures for the postgraduate students as a part of Academy of Scientific and Innovative Research, Chennai, which is like an Indian Institute of Technology and other institutions of national importance. ACSIR established by an Act of Parliament, Government of India. He was a visiting professor from August 2015 to December 2016, EEE Department, BITS Pilani. Authored, also co-authored for more than 100 scientific papers published in peer-reviewed international journals and conferences. Delivered 49 plus invited talks in international, national seminars, conferences, workshops, and guided 3 PhD students, more than 65 M.Tech dissertations. He served as publication chair and convener for the ICAEES 2013 International Conference on Advanced Electronic Systems. He is also a fellow of the Institution of Engineers, India, and lifetime member of the IETE New Delhi. He visited Germany and Japan in the context of research. He has played the key role in materializing the MOU between CSIR, CEERI, Pilani, and Hiroshima University, Japan. We are so glad to invite you, sir. We are waiting for your intellectual talk. Welcome you, sir. Now the session is yours. Thank you, sir.
Thank you for your kind introduction. But it is big world, fine, no problem. Now we are going to start with IoT. Basically, I am trying to share my slides. Now, if you have any problem, then let me know. So, are you able to hear and see my slides?
Yes, sir. Both are perfect, sir. Audio,
right.
And video, sir. Thank you, sir.
That's good. Formally, good morning to everyone. Before I start the talk, basically it is on applications of IoT and design issues. Today, IoT buzzword is, you know, well among academic community as well as industry community, and also R&D community. So there is a big a boom or hype or the reality in future. Whatever we are going to talk about future technology and that IoT is going to have in our daily life. Unfortunately, no technology gets the boom unless they have the revenue generation. Good part of IoT is it also generates a lot of revenue. Also, it provides a lot of facilities to the users. So with this, I would like to say IoT is going to be a part of our life in near future. Most probably within 2-3 years, we are going to have IoT system in everybody's life. Of course, partially we are already IoT, one IoT system. Anybody can answer? This is the negative part of the IoT. Okay, fine. Before entering into the full details of my talk, I would like to talk about my organization. Basically, it's a CSIR Siri Pilani, Central Electronics Engineering Research Institute. And many of you must be knowing what is CSIR, Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, one of the leading R&D organization in the country. Basically, it comes under the Ministry of Science and Technology. Ministry of Science and Technology has three departments, DST, DVT, and the DSIR. In fact, DSIR has been created for the administrative purpose of CSIR. So Secretary of DSIR is Director General of CSIR. So default, once the DG, if DG of CSIR always becomes the Secretary of DSIR. CSIR is the only organization which was constituted in 1942. That means before the independence under the Societal Act of 1860. So with this brief, what for this CSIR is existing is to provide scientific industrial R&D that maximizes the economy, environmental and societal benefits for people of India. So with this mission, CSIR had been started in 1942, and after independence also it has its grow many years. And in 70s, administrative purpose, government of India unable to govern CSIR and CSIR which category. So to remove all those misunderstandings, they created a separate department and DSIR, and DSIR and CSIR parallelly under one person, that is either you can call it DG CSIR or secretary to DSIR. So throughout the country, we have a 38 laboratories, different fields, you name it, any field you can find in one of the CSIR lab. For example, since you are there in the Hyderabad CCMB, ISCT, and NGRI, these three labs are from CSIR. Each lab has one director, and director has complete independence. Even DG, sometimes DG is only to take the information. So, and sometimes, DC is the final authority to distribute the fund. So everybody obeys DC orders also. With this brief introduction about Siri, I would like to talk about our today's content. Basically, I would like to give from the scratch. I know you are already spent a few days in the workshop. Before we start anything to design, you must understand what it is, what it should do, what kind of functional characteristics, what kind of physical characteristics it should have. Those aspects, once if you understand, then most probably your efficiency in the design will lead to a beautiful product. A beautiful idea. That's the idea of the entire slides. I have a sufficient material, but what I'll do, I'll try to skip some of the slides so that you can have just feel, but not details. But at the same time, if anybody is having any doubt, you can raise, you can talk to me, you can stop me in between also. That is better than taking the questions at the end of the day. But at the same time, we need to restrict the questions to complete the talk. So let me take my own way, But you can ask me the questions. If I feel it is good to address right now, then I will address. If I feel it is good to address later part or when the question related material comes, then there I will address or at the end of the talk. These are the three options, but the options I am not giving to you, options I am keeping with me. So this is the how we are going to spend next 2 hours. So first I'll start with the IoT and what are the requirements of IoT. So since it's a new field, many people are having their own way of the definitions, but we need to understand at least what are the standard formulation organizations they are saying about their own way, what is IoT. And you know, I'll give you a small challenge to all the participants. You name it any application which we cannot apply IoT device or IoT technology, and that person really will get appreciation. Since I'm not there physically, otherwise I'll give you the gift also. So now you please start think on where IoT cannot be applied. Once again, I'm repeating, you please think on where IoT cannot be applied. Then after looking at various applications, we will be talking about the features of IoT and the building blocks of the IoT, and then IoT architectural model and different terminologies. See, wherever there is a money, the technology gets a rapid development. Wherever there is a money involvement, the technology also misuse the terminology. But unfortunately, many people talk about the same terminology, hence the terminology becomes a standard. That means if 100 people who are not having a standard, only one person is having standard, and 100 people, whatever they are talking, that should be taken as a terminology. Not the correct one who speaks correctly, but only one. Nobody will bother about that person. There are two reasons for that. One is many people understand what they know. Hence, the single person cannot be, you know, convincing all the people. Number two, one person effort always be neglected by taking the voting mechanism. We call it democracy. So in the democracy, it is possible a wrong person can be a right and right person can be a wrong. But at the same time, what is wrong, what is right, one should understand with the depth of knowledge. So now taking that as a reference, I will give you few terminologies and technologies that are related to the IoT, and then what are the challenges and issues in the IoT system design, and then we will go with the conclusion. So here we would like to start with the initial definition who has given Kevin Austin from IBM. He said IoT is system of interconnected devices. System of interconnected devices. He mentioned this definition in 1991. It's around 29 years completed. So at that point of time, 29 years before, what is the system? The system in general having a general purpose process with the internet, basically TCP/IP, and whatever the system is connected physically, locally, and they were able to talk or they were able to control remotely. That was the definition given by Kevin Austin from IBM. So ultimately, today is also IoT definition is similar, but not same. So what is that? Today's IoT is Internet of Things is all about information visibility. It is not about autonomous decision making. It is about information visibility without any problem in maintaining privacy, security, and confidentiality. That means any device that it is making a visibility of the information, then we can call it IoT. Now, already we are having computers, already we are having servers, already we are having cloud platforms. So there we never call them, already they are doing those function through the TCP/IP, but we never talk about them as Internet of Things. So what is the basic difference between Internet of Things is it should be able to think, it should be able to sense, it should be able to act, it should be able to react, and it should be able to communicate not only with the people, also with the things. Now, if you see this definition, technical definition, IoT is the network of things with the device identification, embedded intelligence, and sensing and actuating capabilities, and connecting people and things over the internet. So this is the simple and the summary of the IoT. Now, with the various scenarios, how they are going to be linked. Now, IoT device, with this definition, we can say anytime, any context, any data, any device can be connected, any place and from anywhere, you can talk. Any path or any network can be used, any service or any business also involving the IoT. So this is how something, you know, a vague, undefined way of introducing IoT. So now we can go ahead with the standard terminologies. So ultimately, before going into that, we need to see what is that IoT device. Sometimes people call it Internet of Everything. Sometimes people call it the Internet of Things. Sometimes people call it Internet of Objects. So all those things are synonymous. Synonyms for the IoT. Basically, they do four functions. One is it is able to connect the people and it does the processing. It transmits and receives the data, and also it connects the physical objectives so that the physical data can be acquired. So ultimately, if you see, it's just like, you know, human being capacity. It's a human being capacity. It can feel, it can hear, it can see, it can smell, it can think, and it can interact smartly wherever it is required. So that's the another kind of IoT definition. So what IEEE says? A network of items, each embedded with the sensors, which are connected to the internet. So our previous technical abbreviation already coming under IEEE. And also, it enables the physical things or objects to sense. That means you can sense, you can feel the environment physically. So when you talk about any time connection, it can be day and night, it can be indoor and outdoor, it can be in the moment. When you talk about a place, the place which are, you know, connected with the PC, the place maybe which are, you know, not connected with the PC, that is cell phones and outdoors and on the move. Any place, That's the meaning. And when you talk about thing, what is that thing? It can be between PCs, it can be human to human, and it can be human to thing, and it can be thing to thing. When you talk about thing, it's a physical sensor. When you talk about thing, it's a when you wanted to make pollution monitoring system, you need to monitor various pollution parameters like temperature, PM3, PM2.5, PM2 and PM10, and dust particles, those things. So how do you do that? Only with the sensors, we sense them, and then after that, we are trying to use those data for further services extraction or profile making. So this is the actual, you can say, definition. When it comes to the same thing, when you talk about the Internet of Thing in the mathematical equation form or some system block diagram, if you see, you can see here the various sensors which are sensing the physical parameters, and the sensor senses physical parameter and gives you the output as electrical signal. When you take the electrical signal is involved in the linearity issues. What are the issues? Linearity issues. What is the linearity? So who are the participants? Let me understand. Are they everybody is from computer science? Hello?
Sir, it is a kind of circuit brand, sir. Maximum electronics, computer science and IT, EEE, other branches are very few.
What about the ratios of these three?
It's the highest ratio, sir. 25%, sir.
Ratios. Ratios means, let us say, 1:0.5 is to 2:2, like that. Okay. Doesn't matter. You can see, if you are not able to understand what it is, please raise your hand or let me take more details. So when you talk about the non-linearity issue, you please take the simple diode or transistor characteristics. So the diode is having non-linearity and the transistor is also having a non-linearity. Those aspects has to be converted into linear. That means everybody will appreciate only linear visibility, linear curve. So you need to bring the non-linear property which is generated by the sensor with the help of either signal conditioning circuits or the pre-processing. You have to bring into them a linearization, and then we need to do some little processing based on the application. The processing can be temperature extraction, the processor can be pressure extraction, the processor can be some physical parameter extraction rather than explaining only in the electrical signal. After that, we will try to transfer the data from one place to another place. You either using short range communication or using long range communication. So when we talk about short range, then we talk about the sensors deployed heavily or sensors deployed group wise. And when you talk about the long range, sensors are not ordered, or you can say long range, it can be collection of from high density sensors and collecting at one place, and from the one place it is going to be distributed to various places distributed among the world. So this is the basic device. Now this is something more, and something which you are able to see the complete understanding. See, now you can see there is always a slight conflict between IoT and CPS. I don't see, but I'll tell you why I don't see, but later on. But now look at the various scenarios of IoT system. Now, as I told you, the long range communication is between gateway and cloud. Long range communication between gateway and cloud. Short range communication between various nodes and edge node. And edge node to the gateway. Sometimes people talk about fog computing. Sometimes people talk about pervasive computing. These aspects are there in the gateway. You know, today, if you search in the IEEE site, the edge node computing is a buzzword. Edge node computing. Now you see this edge node computing is a completely every general is concentrating on edge node computing. So that is the importance of this node, which is taking the data from various end nodes. And each end node is connected to various sensors. And after collecting the data, it is passing the to either a gateway or via gateway to cloud. In between, depending upon the applications, there are cloudlets existing after the gateway. So the cloudlet is infrastructure which is established between gateway and the cloud. Cloudlet is an infrastructure which is established between gateway and cloud. Why it is required, when this is required, I will tell you in the applications. Okay. So now this is the best way of a simple IoT device, which is having long range communication, but data transfer here usually less. Now look at here, there are some edge device, there are some directly connected sensors to edge device, and edge device is doing some computation and extracting services, only useful data or useful service or the data which is in the form of usable is sent to the cloud, or entire raw data also can be sent to the cloud, but real time raw data sending is not necessarily to send the real time in the real time communication. That's the basic scenarios. So now you can see the case one and case two, and then case three and case four, and these are the various scenarios that one can look into. So we have seen what is the definition, and we have also seen what should be the IoT device, and we have seen what are the various scenarios which we can talk about IoT. Or also sometimes I give distributed IoT. Sometimes people say it's a cyber physical systems, but are they same? Are they different? We will see in a soon. So these are the various standard organizations that they are giving the IoT definitions. So after extracting, after understanding all these definitions, I have made initial slides. So OAS is SaaS system where the internet is connected to the physical world via ambiguous sensors. That means sensors are required. One, this is sensors. It is also, IEEE is also saying sensors. OAS is also saying sensors. So, and WC, what it says, a web of things. since they are well versed with the, you know, web page and web page designs, and they talk about web of things. There also they talk about you know, machine to machine communication, and ITU, generally International Telecommunication Standard, it exactly gave what is the anytime and any place and anything sense. So the IoT definition, what we had earlier discussion, is, you know, coinciding. And IETF, Internet of Engineering Task Force, is another important standard organization which talks about the TCP/IP mostly. This is also talk about the things. It is also talking about things, and it is also talking about, so, the sensor and actuator. The sensor and actuator. So that is the definition. And the NIST, which is an American standard organization, very famous for the particularly the ICT technology. The IoT under the umbrella of cyber physical systems, they are trying to define. As I told you, the many times the cyber physical systems people refer as Internet of Things. That may not be completely correct, but what is the right term is, cyber physical systems can be distributed IoT system. And IoT system is not necessarily a cyber physical system. Please try to understand the basic definition. Cyber physical system is not necessarily be IoT, but at the same time, a large number of IoT devices can be called as cyber physical systems. And this is the definition took from the NIST. And there are other standard projects from the European countries, and they also talk about linking physical and virtual objects through exploitation of data capture. So once again, sensor and actuation is coming into the picture. So that whatever the definition that we are giving, they are equally valid. And from this, from now onwards, what we can talk, these IoT device and the cyber physical systems, they are interrelated. Cyber physical system, we talk when high density sensors are deployed. When you talk about high density sensors, wireless sensor networks comes into the picture. They will be divided into clusters or slots, and each cluster is having at the cluster head, and the computer science guys are happy to hear at the cluster head, because the wireless sensor networks, complete concepts can be used in the IoT. And when we talk about the node design and the end node design, connecting the physical sensor and all these things, normally people talk about either ECE, EEE, and when it comes to the wireless sensor network and the communication aspect, people talk about IT and CSE. Unfortunately, the scenario has changed. Now, the end node design no more related to only ECE or EEE or instrumentation, and it is also related to IT and CSE. And the dealing with the communication protocols, talking about TCP/IP and lower layer protocols, is not the job of only IT and CSE. It is also a job of ECE. Unfortunately, the EEE cannot handle, because they are not having the communication subject. That's the drawback with the EEE, but they have application domain knowledge, like execution of motor running programs, or controlling remotely devices and infrastructure and machinery. there they can also contribute, including mechanical and civil engineers. Of course, as I told you, any engineer can work with the IoT. Any engineer, including doctors, can work with the IoT. That's the reason I said, you tell me one application where IoT cannot be utilized. So now IoT and physical system, CPS already I have explained you, and WSN is also explained. Now, when a small environment scenario comes, then we call it IoT system. When it comes to the large environment, then obviously either we can call a distributed IoT or the cyber physical systems. So these are the various definitions, understandings, what is IoT. So with this understanding, we will try to see what should be the characteristics. They have to have a data and event-driven based systems, because they have to respond either for event or for the data. So the system is interactive. It should be interactive. So for the interactive aspects, if you see, how can I interact with my computer? I have a mouse, I have a keyboard, but in general, if I wanted to interface, or if I wanted to interact with my computer, then my computer should understand what I am speaking. So that understanding generally can be done through a data-driven event or event-driven. So next, it should have an ambient intelligence, and then it should have a flexible structure. Why it should be a flexible structure? Because the same node can be used short-range communication, also can be used long-range communication. Sometimes the node gives you the profile, sometimes the cloud platform gives you the profile. So you need to connect to the user as well as you need to connect to the cloud platform. Sometimes you need to do more computations. Sometimes you need to do, simply passing the raw data. So another important aspect is semantic sharing. So data mining aspect, how to acquire the data, how to store the data, how to retrieve the data. These are the very important aspects. Unfortunately, there is a well established techniques are available at present for computer or server based or cloud platform based, but not for IoT technology. What is the basic difference between is either computer or server or cloud platform, they are not having any or mostly the resource constraints. They will be having, but they are not having very deadly resource constraints. What does that mean, deadly resource constraints? I can have a hard disk in my computer up to 20 TB, but in the IoT node, it's a maximum 2-3 GBs, maximum that too. So I can have a Xeon processor, but in the IoT device, I cannot have Xeon processor. It consumes a lot of power. So I can only have the limited low power consuming processors, like MSP432, ARM-based microcontrollers, and the other microcontrollers who are consuming very less energy or less power consumption. Another one is the complex access technologies. My device should be able to communicate long range as well as short range. That means I must deal with multiple standards. One is ZigBee, the other one is Bluetooth, third one is LTE, fourth one is TCP/IP. And all of them should be provided not on the Xeon-based computer, It is a simple 8085 microcontroller or ARM-based 32-bit ARM-based microcontroller, or slightly but not rich resources. So they are having, you know, these are the features or characteristics of the IoT. So based on that, there are 10 features. All the features I don't talk about, but I'll talk about the ambiguity. Ambiguity is the one where the dynamic routing protocol algorithms are implemented. A lightweight dynamic routing protocols are implemented to make effective communication. The another important thing is, many people talk about my device is IoT device. Fine, your device is IoT device. Okay, can your device talk to another vendor of the same protocol standard? For example, Texas Instruments supplies a chip like CC2520. They claim it's a Zigbee compatible. Can I talk to Silicon Lab produced chip? They also claim Zigbee compatible chip. Can I talk, or can I establish the communication between them? That is necessary. It is not happening today, because though standard is same and everything is same, but they are trying to use a proprietary security aspect. Because of that, the decoding problems are coming. Though format and everything is same as per the protocol, but the decoding aspect is coming, and the mechanism of identification of the protocol is coming. Hence, they are not interoperable. But how can we make IoT system interoperable? That's the one challenge. This challenge can be taken IT, CSC, and ECE people. The another one is, the device is working in the remotely, and the deployment of the device density is very high. And starting from 10,000 devices to millions of devices which are, you know, deployed for a single application. I'll talk about where that scenario comes. Look at that scenario. Now, how can I make interoperable communication among the devices? The another requirement for the interoperable communication is, one fellow uses BLE as a short range, the other fellow uses as Zigbee as a short range. In this case, how can I have the communication among them? That is the, you know, biggest challenge. The another one is self-configuration, self-adaptation. Because of remotely deployed devices, the 2 lakhs of devices, and if I don't provide self-debugging or self-testing feature, the device may work as IoT device, but you don't know when it is going to die. And you don't know whether it is alive or died. So these are the two things can be solved by self-configuration and self-adaptation. So in the self-configuration case, we can talk about what kind of protocol I'm talking. Right now I'm talking with the BLE to BLE. Now the other fellow is Zigbee. Now I should be able to configure myself as Zigbee. Now other third fellow is a Wi-Fi. Now I should be able to configure myself as a Wi-Fi. So if you can do that, that's called a self-configuration within the device. And adaptation, is my sensor is working properly? If not, how to make it workable? Is there any excitation problem? Or is there any input problem? Or the sensor dead because of the battery off or battery low? Or sensor dead because of, you know, because of the aging sensor itself is not working. So these are all issues, design issues one has to look into in the IoT edge node design or end node design. So this is, you know, once again, ECE, TPE and instrumentation can be a right people to tackle all of them. But now, whether you are TPE or instrumentation or ECE, you cannot escape understanding the TCP/IP suit, and also you cannot escape the communication aspects which are involved throughout the IoT systems. Hence, I call the IoT system is specific, and it is neither belonging to none of these branches, nor we can say nobody is belonging to, it is belonging to everyone. What I can say, it itself is a specific, but anybody can involve 5 to 6 branches easily, and rest of the branches, application domain development. Rest of the branches, application domain development. See, if you are really good, you are a civil engineer and you are really good for electronics and fascinating, and you can use the ready-made IoT models to implement like the structural monitoring, and maybe you can see the rehabilitation of high structures and many other aspects you can implement. Mechanical people, they can design remotely the machines. They can design machines online. They can repair machines online. So they can predict the mission lifetime. They can predict mission performance using IoT. So these are all the various features that are really required. And of course, these are all various devices, Bitworld, but they are all already available in the market. So now we will look at the, so far, any doubts from the audience? I think this is the drawback of, you know, remotely giving the lecture, and that too with the limitation of the bandwidth. Had I been able to see all the faces, I'll see your face, whether are you able to understand or not. But now you are not giving any reply. So assuming, taking the time into the consideration, you don't have any doubt. So these are all various applications. As I told you, everywhere you can apply this IoT technology. Importantly, health monitoring of buildings, bridges, heavy structures, gas and pipelines. Smart city concept heavily uses IoT. Also, the IoT enabled system to detect the adulteration of milk or food products and food supply chain. So, smart water grid, energy water, smart grid and energy internet. There are many applications. So if you see the future technology, how we are going to evolve. Now we are already at this moment, the 2020, and this paper published in 2014. Now look at this. We are going to have holographic TV, and energy is the major key. And I am happy to see the green energy as your workshop title. Though you are belonging to the CSC group, but putting the IoT for green energy systems, that itself makes me happy. Since you are not biased with the subject, so that is one thing. And now in this year we are going to have the smart energies, and tomorrow we are going to have virtual reality, augmented reality. Virtual reality is more on theoretical, augmented reality is more on physical parameter sensing. So now we are talking about the simulations. Simulations with the mathematical equations. Many times people may not be knowing what is the significance of this waveform or simulation results. But in near future, we are going to have augmented reality and virtual reality. One is theoretically what can be done. The other one is a physical real system, how it looks like. One best example is, if you want to visit a Tirupati, a temple, if you want to feel a Tirupati temple place in your home, that is possible. It's not only the way we are showing today video. It's a physical touch, up to physical touch, it is possible. You feel you are physically touching the Lord Venkateshwara. You feel the physically you are doing namaskar the Lord Lord Venkateshwara with the VR and AR technology. That's kind of once again IoT technology. Basically IoT can be used in everywhere. So that's the feature of things. Now the I can be FOT. So anything is possible with the IoT technology. So what are the various aspects that are available one has to look into? See, I have not given you details of the applications, but I'm giving something, where you can do what. See, when you have the sensors can be many types. It can be medical, it can be neural, environmental, chemical, and infrared, and camera, and AR, VR cameras. So those things are here, okay? Anything that one can look into, the proper efficient sensor to sense the required parameter from the environment. That is one of the challenge. The another challenge is, as I told you, non-linear aspects, avoiding or reducing non-linear to non-linear aspects or converting non-linear to linear. So the techniques that we required, that is signal conditioning circuit or the lookup table based techniques that can be used for converting non-linearity to linearization. Then communication. Communication, it itself is huge opportunities are available, but at the same time, we required a beautiful infrastructure to do R&D in communication. What we do, we try to do simulations either using NS3, NS2, and any other environment. But unfortunately, if you see the wireless sensor network for the last 20 years, if you look for the papers or literature, the majority of the papers are available for, wireless sensor networks. But in reality, that much efficient short-range communications does not appeared in the practical. The reason is many of our brothers, they do a simulation. They produce some graphs. They publish. They get degree or they finish the project. If they are doing degree, PhD degree, once they publish it and the graph variations are novelty, and those novelties are talking about performance and the performance is they are talking about energy and computation and the reliability of the communication, everything on the simulation environment. That's the reason they were not turned into a practical aspects. So what is really required is the practical aspects. So the simulation environments are required, but the simulation environment should be translatable to the practical system. The way we are going to see in the future is a VR virtual reality is going to a theoretical aspect. Augmented reality is going to be a practical aspect based on this environmental creation. So you can create the environment within this simulation, and based on that you can do that. And the creation of that physical environment itself is a challenge, requires a lot of mathematics. And for that, now the challenge is digital twin. Digital twin platforms are coming. So the digital twin platform creates the physical environment. VR platform creates the communication aspect and brings you your Lord Venkateshwara temple to your computer. Please look at the practical aspect. Okay, I can feel it, I can touch it, but what about my smell? How can I smell that environment? So that is also possible. That is also possible with the augmented reality. Okay, how it is possible? You have to use the control system, and based on that, you have to control. So for example, let us say if you get a bad smell, this can be removed by spraying room fresheners. So you can control room fresheners like that. You can control fragrances. You can take real fragrance by using augmented reality. So that's the one aspect. Of course, for application development, you required a middleware and applications. Applications, anybody, any engineer, any doctor, any human being in this world can be developed this application layer. And middleware is required to handle interoperability, energy efficiency, self-configuration, self-adaptation, and fault tolerance. You can also implement this middleware in the hardware for high-end requirements. This is the basic research topics can be accommodated any engineer here, can be accommodated any doctor here, can be accommodated by anybody. The only thing is he or she should know what he or she wants to do and where she can contribute. She should know or he should know. Then you can make real contributions. In general, a typical another problem in designing the system, IoT system, is everybody talks about edge node, everybody talks about communication, many people talk about like me, interoperability, self-configuration, and everything. Fine. What about the physical sensing parameters? What are the real sensors which can be deployed and take the data? Based on that, your system has to be designed. You cannot design a single system for all the applications. You cannot design a single system for all the sensors data acquisition. You cannot design a single system to control all kind of applications. I will control mission, I will control vehicle, I will control my door, I will control my home appliances, I will control my pollution, I will control my environment and everything. But there should be a customization. Otherwise, the IoT definition will not survive. Why? If you make everything general, you require high computing. If you want a high computing, then you required high power. Then if you want a high power, then you have to pay more money. And IoT device is not meant for that. So you required to understand what is the application, what are the sensors. How can I make those sensors connected to my node so that economically I can produce my IoT design? So that's the major important. So few applications and the sensors I have given, like healthcare, biosensors are required, and initial things are required. And for example, in the many times, you know, safety and security aspects are important. So there, accelerometer and the magnetometer and chemical sensors and gyrometers are required. See, the sensors can be a wobble up one application to another application, but it should be a set of. So the handling accelerometer sensor is not that easy. The way you can handle any other floating point based values, like discrete value producing sensors, are easy to connect. But you know, sampling based sensors producing is not really, you know, acquisition of that sensor data is not really easy, not trivial, not conventional. You should have a specific technique to connect and extract the data from the sensors. So as I told you, applications, few applications we can see: healthcare, transportation, industry, market, school, vehicle, smart home, and agriculture. See, many times what happens when we apply for the project or when we talk about the PhD thesis or when we talk about our own way of implementation of the R&D project, okay, what is the novel? Very frequent question generally people ask, what is the novelty? By either we should be at top, that means ahead of the world, so that the novelty can come, or we should be able to implement the technology to our needs. The technology to improve our environment, maybe our agriculture, maybe our health aspects, maybe our transportation. Let it be the same from outside the country, but are we able to do practically? That's the challenge. Then I will say there is a lot of novelty that you are adapting to heavy rush and more disaster high populated environment. For that, what are the things that are required to before designing the system, or what design aspects you need to incorporate to implement your own environment? That is more important rather than talking about novelty when compared to the world. If I can able to implement AR, VR technology to the education, the way I am able to touch the Lord Venkateshwara feet, if I am able to talk to my teacher, and if I am able to give the attention the way I am giving attention in the class to each and every participant of the candidate, that itself is a novelty. So that's the design aspect. How can I make it? I'm having huge large number of students. So how can I handle remotely so that tomorrow COVID or worse than that pandemic comes, I can handle, I can teach the way I am teaching in the class. Can we think on that? Can we implement practically that aspect? That itself is a novelty for getting into the R&D aspect. Unfortunately, we don't look at ourselves. We look at others. Because we are looking at others, the appearance of others trying to imitate in ourselves. You look at yourself, how you are beautiful. You change your shapes, your clothes.
Sir, sorry for the disturbance, sir. People are always doing this annotation, sir. We are not able to control because it's in the presenter side, sir. We can go to more and disable participant annotation one will be there, sir. That we need to apply, sir. So that... Because I'm taking a lot of screenshots, sir. It's becoming this kind of obstacles.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Then on clicking annotate, clear button, delete or clear button will be there, sir. With that, it will both will be cleared, sir.
It's fine. No problem. I don't have any problem.
Thank
it's
you,
fine.
Sir.
Okay. So the next one is, healthcare and IoT. See, today, look at our hospitals, including private and government. Can we use the IoT technology to solve our health problems? Can we bring villages using AR/VR technology to cities' doctors? See, we always try to blame doctors. Unfortunately, the doctors are not corrupt. The system is corrupt. The corporate hospital management is corrupt. Because of that, the doctors, because they have to survive. To survive, they are saying, yes, sir. Hence, the loot is happening in the corporate hospitals. Can we do something so that, without the corporate hospital, with the community hospitals, with the well-established doctors' help, can we treat our patients? Can we provide health facility to the villagers? That's the challenge. Think on those aspects. What are the things that are required? Can I interface X-ray? Can I interface ultrasonic system? Can I interface CT scanner to my IoT device? So that the online data can be visible to an expert doctor? That's the challenge. That's the real challenge. And now, if you want to have the interface, then you need to understand what is the interface standards. USB, USB 2.0, USB 3.0, USB 3.1, USB Type-C, USB Mini, USB, the latest one is coming. So, all those aspects, can you take the data in the form of USB and the interface and display? Now, what are the X-ray machine is giving the interface? Is it VGA? Is it HDMI? Or is it AVI? What is that interface it is giving? So you need to understand. And then you interface that from the X-ray machine to your IoT device. And once you are interface, rest is very easy. You can implement algorithms, you can transfer the data, you can make AR/VR technology to visualize real aspects. Everything is possible. But critical part is interfacing. That one has to look into this particular aspect. The another aspect is, your IoT device should match the medical device standard. Your IoT device should match the medical device standards. That's the another requirement when you talk about IoT system design to health care. Okay, next, the personal aspects. Nowadays, everybody is more stress, enjoying stress is the habit. Nowadays, many people are enjoying the stress. So mostly that may not be required if you use your technology. Why we feel the stress? Because we miss the aspects. Because we don't want actual things in time. Maybe personal behavior. We forget. We have the postponing attitude, or we have the current more pressing attitude. We don't plan properly. Sometimes laziness. Sometimes entertainment mood. All those things are giving me something which I am forgetting my office work, something which I am forgetting my family work, something which I am forgetting my children work. So if I have the IoT system which can give me all these things by on its own, my IoT device should not ask me to enter. My IoT device should not ask me to say. My IoT device should understand me, what I am doing, what I am talking, what I am committing. For example, let us say somebody called me and can you give me the talk on the, let us say, 25th. Since I don't know whether it is there or not, what I'll do? Okay, I'll see and I'll tell you whether I am free or not. But if my IoT device gives me, look, Solomon, on 25th, you are free from 2 to 4. The way a personal assistant gives me, sir, this is your program. Similarly, any IoT device, if it gives me such kind of information, then most probably I will not forget. And also I'll complete. Nobody is a bad person in this world. Everybody is good. But why bad people are coming out? Because the competitive world, because the small mistakes which we do are trying to hide. The small mistakes, because of our hectic schedule, we are not able to complete. We are not able to remember those aspects. Can we make such a device? Don't talk about Google Assistant. Don't talk about your reminders. Don't talk about your calendar. Some partial function they are doing, but they are not doing sufficiently. So can we do such a IoT device development? That's one thing. So next, if you see, I'm going to skip many applications. These are all two things. Next one is smart home, and this one is your theme workshop theme. So you can see here, smart grid and energy of internet. What are the things that we need to look into? The one is the generation. Can we make a microcontroller grid so that we can look into? Narasimha. So the aspects what we need to see is, one is generation, the other one distribution, and then optimized storage, and then transmission. The less distance you transmit, the more efficient. That is one aspect. And the smart metering, nobody should steal the energy. That is the basic requirement. And smart power grid and using wireless communication, and also using the power grid communication network, and also making the controllers and the load distribution and energy distribution as per the load requirement. These are all the various design aspects one has to look into. Next, if you see these are all the world statistics. Ultimately, what I wanted to tell these slides are, energy is more important. Any developed country, the basic, any developed country, if you want to say, the basic minimum requirement is 24 hours for any appliance running from any place should be available. That's the first requirement to be, I am developed country. I belong to developed country. My country is developed. If you want to claim the 24 hours energy supply for any kind of application is a must. That's the first requirement. So the next one is, how can I generate a cheaper energy? How can I generate cheaper energy? The first requirement is 100% to 100% people provision of this. The next requirement is, how can I reduce the cost of the energy? These are the two aspects which are really required. People talk about renewable energy using solar, wind, and many other mechanisms. But I personally feel solar energy required a maturity of the technology. The solar cells required, more efficient solar cells required. So those aspects one has to look into. And with the solar, the moment you talk about the smart grid, the industrial instrumentation comes into the picture, and the real-time aspects are going to come into the picture. So that is, you know, technology is Industry 4.0. So Industry 4.0, another, fiction. That fiction comes into reality within a few years. It is like this. If I wish, I want 4 computers from my machine, then 4 computers will come. I want 4 tablets, tabs, 4 tabs will come. I want 4 laptops, 4 laptops will come. I want Apple laptops will come. So that's the scenario that we are looking into the future industry. So the kind of work, what I wanted to say, the kind of work that is required to be done is enormous. Even for the world level, nobody is having the practical Industry 4.0 based system. Because Industry 4.0 is giving that much imagination, like it's like a novel Harry Potter. It's like a novel Harry Potter. So the way Harry Potter flies, the way Harry Potter faces, the way Harry Potter imagination becomes the reality. That is actually the Industry 4.0 is talking about today. It flies, it runs, it stops, it does. just the way if you just say one command. So that is the one of the important thing. So many aspects are required. So now I'm going to skip to other applications. So so because many things are there to discuss, but I'm skipping everything. This thing I would like to share. See, another important application is structural health monitoring. It can be bridges. It can be a big structure, big boiler, which is running for many years. Nobody knows whether this is a healthy condition or not. That's the reason in industry that gas leakages, which are happening in the, you know, which happened in Visakhapatnam, and which was happened in Gujarat, and many other places, just chemical leakage. And chemical leakage gives you the crack. Initially, the crack is very minute, and slowly, very minute and not visible, and slowly develops, and one day it blasts. You can avoid using those things. This is the technology really required in India. All of suddenly bridges collapse because of this aspect. All of suddenly the building collapse because of this aspect. Some of the aspects are disaster management, the disasters. Some of the things are happening because of the disasters. Some of the things are happening because we are not able to maintain properly. Some of the things are happening because the, a feeling to earn money without hard working. The feeling, let people die, but I'll earn money because of this reason. The feeling, okay, if I get 10 paisa, the others are losing 1 rupee, I don't mind. I am more conscious about my 10 paisa. So what is the today's industry they are doing? What people we are doing and how government is doing? All those aspects are pushing back to bring your IoT technology. Neither industry nor government is, you know, ready to use this technology. What they want to say, we wanted to use this technology. But if you go for the idea, they will give you 100 excuses. So what I give you idea, you implement first. Straight away demonstrated prototype, just demonstrated, then they cannot reject. But if you want to implement a system which will make automatic police control room functions, like identifying the vehicles which are going beyond 80 kilometers per hour, and identifying the vehicles without number plate, and somebody hit and run case. Those cases to avoid, you can easily implement the IoT system. But the system ideas, they don't support because they have their own weaknesses. Instead of asking them, implement first and then you say, my system does all these things. They cannot refuse. That is what I wanted to say. Government or any environment, they don't want implement any transparent system. But they act like I wish. The government wishes. The government wants to do it. or the system wants to do it. Even in academia, people doesn't want to have a system to measure what is the quality of their teacher. No teacher is ready for accepting that. And even R&D in that aspect, even industry in that aspect. Are you following all the standard norms? Are you following the pollution norms? No. They are not ready for installing the system which will tell you the pollution level. The system which will tell you the quality of teaching. The system which will tell you the weaknesses of any system. No system accepts that. But unfortunately, how to overcome? Without overcoming, we cannot survive in near future. The only solution is you first implement, at least to prototype, and then show demonstration, and then people will accept. One of that is structural health monitoring. What we are trying to do, we are trying to monitor bridge remotely, connecting to the cloud via mobile app. In the mobile app, you can also see what is happening in the bridge, on the bridge, or bridge health condition. Also, you can see the fast history from the cloud and current situation from the bridge. This system already we are developing. This function, collecting the data from the bridge to mobile, is over. Now, instead of cloud, we are using server. Instead of cloud, we are using server. So that, for example, if you want to see health of the bridge, it sends the inquiry to server, cloud platform, and from the cloud platform, it updates the data, and sometimes it can also take the data from the a bridge, but there you will get only present values, not past or predicted values. Then it says about the health of the bridge, and then it will say if it is good, then it goes to the another bridge. From the another bridge also, the same thing can be done. That means the engineer, if he is a really sensible engineer, he can sit in his room and look at all the health status. When he goes from out of the office, then he keeps mobile application. And if he is really sensible, or if he is really expecting something is going to be, you know, happen bad, those things he can continuously monitor, even he is in the mobile or in the travel or in the function or in anywhere. Only the thing is, he requires to have considerable consciousness whether to look now or whether is this serious or not. That is one thing he needs to understand, and then he can monitor from any place. So we can remove or we can reduce the disasters due to man-made mistakes, due to natural mistakes, the disasters that are, you know, happening. So those things we can see the one of the application, and I'm skipping a small video, so I'll go to the straight away. So already I have given you these aspects also. So where you required, I'll tell you. See, look at this particular thing. When you talk about the IoT, you require domain knowledge, definitely. It depends on what kind of application you are trying to do. And you require to understand what is the system architecture and deployment point of view. That is node design, sensors placement, capturing the data, and the communication aspect. The communication aspect, once again, many communications. People are getting confused what kind of standard one has to look into. And what is the life cycle of the, you know, product or IoT that it is going to be deployed. Capturing the data, producing the services, and the applications. Based on these things, now when you try to design, energy efficient system to capture the data from sensors, to transmit the data. When you try to see the communication aspect, try to provide a lightweight, secure algorithms, lightweight routing algorithms, and lightweight mechanisms at the MAC layer. So they are the requirement. And when it comes to the application, the reliability, availability, and serviceability. These are the three aspects one has to look into. Reliability is, what is the application, typical application? People claim 10 years warranty. People claim lifetime warranty. How it is possible? The way we are taking lifetime warranty today, is this the way? Till you get the item, people talk about 10 years warranty and lifetime warranty. After purchasing, they brought a new rules. Lifetime means not for all, only chip. If chip goes bad, then I will replace. If interface goes bad, I am not responsible. If pin goes bad, I am not responsible. Only chip we are giving the guarantee that we have already written in the star. The star font, normal font is 8, the star font is 2. Normal above 50 years people, it is very hard to read. Below 50 years people does not want to read. So the product guarantee is, you know, not fulfilled the purpose. So in tomorrow, these things will not be, no more you can play this kind of tricks. Act of God, no more valid. So all these things are going to change, and based on that, your device has to be, you know, worked. So 10 years, SHO, no building collapse before 40 years. Once you implant or once you deploy any IoT permanent system, it should be more than 50 years. It should be more than 50 years. How it is possible? How can we provide? What is the plan